Hey Worcester, my name is Jacqueline Burmeister and I'm the coordinator of the Worcester Lakes and Ponds program. Today I am thrilled to share with you the results of our water quality monitoring program in 2020 at Lake Quinsigamond. This video is part of a 5-video series on the state of the lakes in 2020 in Worcester, Massachusetts. If you enjoy it, please be sure to check out our other resources at worcesterma.gov. At over 750 acres, Lake Quinsigamond is the largest lake in Worcester. In some locations, it's up to 85 feet deep. It's a naturally formed lake that spans three municipalities, Worcester on the west, Shrewsbury on the east, and Grafton to the south. The water body boasts two state-run beaches and a public boat ramp. Given its size and span, Lake Quinsigamond hosts a variety of recreational activities, bringing in people from all over to fish, row, swim, jet ski, among many other activities. However, Lake Quinsigamond has also been identified as threatened by invasive aquatic vegetation, fecal bacteria, and nutrient loading by the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. Since 2017, the Lakes and Ponds program has been sampling Lake Quinsigamond twice monthly between May and November in the open water and its major tributaries. This is in addition to the fecal bacteria testing that occurs at the public beaches by the Department of Conservation and Recreation and other locations by the Lake Quinsigamond Watershed Association and the Town of Shrewsbury. This year, for the first time, we were able to extend our sampling season at Lake Quinsigamond with the acquisition of a larger boat, allowing us to capture some of the unique dynamics of the lake during the colder months. These are some of the data that we'll be reviewing today. Let's begin with fecal bacteria. Every week during the summer at the Lake Quinsigamond public beaches, the Massachusetts Department of Conservation and Recreation, or DCR, tests the water at the shore for Enterococcus. This is an indicator of fecal bacteria that can make you sick. If there are too many bacteria, they have to close the beach until the result decreases. Beach closures have been a challenge at Lake Quinsigamond in the past, but in 2019, there was only one day of a beach closure at Regatta Point for the entire summer, which is very good. We had high hopes for 2020. However, we were not so lucky. At Lake Park Beach, we experienced 8 days of beach closures during the bathing season. Regatta Point Beach fared much worse, being closed for approximately 40 of the 70 days of the season. While the problem was not as severe as in 2018, in a year when demand for outdoor activities was higher than ever, Lake Park Beach was closed more than it was open. The source of this issue needs to be identified and addressed, and the Lakes and Ponds program is working on developing methods to track and mitigate fecal bacteria, which we'll discuss in another video. However, it is important to note that DCR was not always sampling again immediately after they made a decision to close a beach or keep it closed, and the total number of samples they took over the course of the season was relatively low. This means that a high result in the beginning of the season weighs more on the geometric mean, even if the risk has passed and the current daily sample result is low. The available data suggests that if more samples were taken, the beach may have been opened sooner. While the protocol used to close beaches is effective at keeping people safe, it will keep the beach closed longer than necessary if not enough samples are taken after a real bacteria event. Whatever bacteria issues were being seen at the beach, they were not witnessed in the open water. Of the 30 samples taken in the open lake by both the Lake Quinsigamond Watershed Association and the Lakes and Ponds program, none had levels of fecal bacteria that would pose a threat to primary contact recreation such as swimming. In any case, bacteria were a challenge for recreation at Lake Quinsigamond in 2020 due to the high number of beach closures. Clarity is how clear the water is of algae and sediment that can be harmful to fish and wildlife. Clear waters are not just more attractive, but they are also generally healthier. Lake Quinsigamond always has been known for its high level of water clarity. This pattern continued in 2020 during the normal sampling season. With the exception of a rain event in mid-October, all clarity results at Lake Quinsigamond were between 11 and 16 feet, meaning that you could see between 11 and 16 feet underwater, which is considered good to excellent by the state of Massachusetts. This is great for recreation. This year, we were able to sample later into the season, and so when normally we would pack up after these good November readings, we stayed out and sampled more. What we found is that while water during the recreational season was excellent for clarity, as late November hit, there was a big drop. Given that this is our first year collecting these samples, it's not possible to know if this is an annual occurrence, but we can try to make sense of what we see with the data that we've collected and anecdotal clues that we have. In 2020, we were excited to launch a brand new water quality monitoring device, a continuous monitoring buoy. This novel Frisbee-sized solar-powered device has the capability to measure water quality every 15 minutes and send the results in real time via cellular signal. This is especially useful on a lake as big as Lake Quinsigamond. We deployed two of these buoys in the open water, where we began testing the technology. We received preliminary results in July for several parameters, including harmful algae pigments, turbidity, and water temperature. Thankfully, for most of the summer, we saw no indication of harmful algal activity. However, in mid-October, we did see something happen in our readouts. Around the time that we saw an uncharacteristic drop in water clarity during a rain event in October, we saw a spike in turbidity at the southern monitoring buoy. It being the first year that we were using the buoy, we did not know what we were dealing with until we received some visual documentation. On October 14th, we received a photograph from a resident from the Lakeshore Condominiums on the Worcester side of the lake. What seems like muddy water is entering the lake from under the Route 9 bridge. We immediately reached out to the sewer department and were relieved to find out that there were no sewer line issues. As it turned out, the discharge was from a construction site on Belmont Street with a large area of exposed erodible soils. After a fairly dry season, it had rained over 2 inches in less than 24 hours, leading to unanticipated surface water outbreaks and overwhelming the erosion controls installed at the site. The resulting flow of turbid water was more than the city's structural water quality unit could treat, resulting in discharges of sediment into the lake. The Conservation Commission was informed and immediately began working with the developers through an enforcement action to correct the issues. These actions effectively addressed erosion from this construction site, but unfortunately, other neighboring construction sites caused additional sediment runoff after a large rain event in November and again in January. The Conservation Commission again issued enforcement actions to the contributing sites and required immediate action to remedy these issues and employ additional measures to prevent future sediment discharges. The battery for our remote monitor died shortly after this first event, and we had to return the units to the manufacturer for the season. So unfortunately, we were not able to get an idea of how long it took for the sediment to clear. But we do hope that in the future, we will be able to use these buoys to give us an early warning about these events. It is always the city's goal to prevent sediment discharges in the first place, which are hazardous to aquatic wildlife and shallow the lake. The City of Worcester requires erosion controls to be used in any construction project, and the Conservation Commission reviews and monitors projects to prevent and, when necessary, correct erosion and water resource impacts. Worcester has enacted a local ordinance that extends the Conservation Commission's jurisdiction beyond what is defined in the state's Wetland Protections Act. Residents have an opportunity to be part of the permitting and compliance process and ensure that our important and sensitive water resources are protected by attending meetings, asking questions during permitting, and supporting regulatory changes and resources dedicated to increased oversight. Residents are also encouraged to immediately report to the city any erosion control or sedimentation issues observed. The sediment discharge explains the lower water clarity experienced in October and November, but what about the rest of the season? On November 27th, we received this photo from a local resident. It appeared that there was algae in the lower reaches of the lake near the shoreline. When we were able to investigate on December 1st, we found that the water clarity was not just low, but that the water had a green tinge to it. We continued to monitor the situation, and with some microscopy, confirmed that the organism that was causing the bloom was indeed a cyanobacterium, a phanomenazon. Cyanobacteria, or harmful algae, are naturally occurring microscopic organisms that use light and nutrients for food. Given the opportunity, they can form blooms that are capable of negatively affecting water quality and producing toxins that are harmful if humans or pets are exposed. Thankfully, the issue began to clear itself up by December 3rd, about a week later. Unfortunately, it was not gone for good. For the first time that anyone could remember, on March 3rd, algae was seen under the ice on Lake Quinsigamond. It was identified as the same cyanobacterium and eventually cleared up after a few days. Thankfully, the only time that we are seeing these events is in the winter when there is limited human exposure to the water, but cyanobacteria can be harmful to the local ecology as well as humans. Because this is the first time that these events have been reported, it is hard to say how common they are, but let's try to understand why they're here. One of the main drivers of harmful algal blooms is the availability of key nutrients like phosphorus that cyanobacteria are efficient at absorbing as food for growth and reproduction. When we measured for the presence of phosphorus on the surface of the lake during the normal sampling season, in many cases the results were below the detection limit of the analysis. It makes sense why the water was so clear during this time. There were few nutrients available at the surface of the lake for the algae to consume. However, when we measured phosphorus at the bottom of the lake, we saw an increasing amount of phosphorus throughout the season. The pattern is not unfamiliar in the southern portion of the lake, but this was the first year that we saw it in the northern portion as well. This phosphorus is not available to cyanobacteria at this time, who tend to live in the upper portion of the lake where there is plenty of light. The reason that this phosphorus doesn't mix into the upper layers of the lake is for a phenomenon known as lake stratification. If you measure temperature going from the surface of the lake down to the bottom in August, you get a graph like this, with a sharp decline in water temperature at a certain depth. This decline in temperature also marks a change in density. Warm water is lighter, floating on top of denser, cold water. This also creates a physical boundary for the bottom phosphorus, which is difficult to cross. But as summer turns to fall, the barrier becomes less and less intense as the water on the top cools. What we found sampling later this year is that in early December, the lake is able to fully mix again, allowing the phosphorus to come to the surface and be made available to cyanobacteria there, potentially fueling a winter bloom. Another hypothesis for the cyanobacteria this year is the increased presence of the invasive mollusk Corbicula fluminea. Non-native plants and animals can outcompete local wildlife and disrupt ecosystem balance. While we have known this mollusk to be present for some time in the lake, we have not yet seen it directly affecting our ability to recreate. However, recent studies suggest that Corbicula could be selectively filter feeding on algae that usually compete with cyanobacteria, allowing the cyanobacteria to prosper. To better understand the extent of this issue, we are working with MassDEP to develop a clam tracking program across our lakes. As far as other invasive species, the Lake Quinsigamond Commission oversees the implementation of an invasive aquatic plant management program. Back in 2018, they identified 6 invasive aquatic plants that were threatening to outcompete local flora and disrupt recreation. With their management action, they were able to significantly reduce the invasive plant population to the point that we did not even need to treat the lake in 2020. The Lakes and Ponds Program plans to continue to support the Commission to manage invasive aquatic plants in 2021. Because of its size, Lake Quinsigamond can be difficult to oversee, especially in its more informal public access points, such as Brownie Beach, where litter from users can accumulate. In 2020, a year when all water bodies had increased use, this problem was amplified to the point of making headlines in the TNG. While some local residents made great efforts to help the control of litter by going out weekly to pick it up, other residents continued to abuse these areas, making them unsafe and unsightly for all. Knowing how to impress our responsibility to these resources on people is not yet obvious, but the Lakes and Ponds Program is looking for a way to better quantify the litter challenge so that we could better understand what methods of litter control are most effective. While stormwater and nutrients are one thing, people often ask about the legacy of the region's industrial past and how emerging contaminants can be affecting our present-day water quality. So in 2019, on 2 separate occasions, we tested the water at Lake Quinsigamond for almost 200 contaminants that would be associated with industry, from volatile and semi-volatile organic compounds like paint and aerosols to heavy metals, petroleum products, and pesticides. We found for a majority of these items, nothing was detected, which is great news. We did find slight traces of PFAS, perfluoroaromatic compounds, which are found in waterproofing agents and firefighting foams. However, these were not at levels that would be considered unsafe, even in drinking water. Of the metals that we found, they were all reflective of the natural metals that would be found in soils. We don't expect that these results would have changed significantly in 2020, but we'll retest for them in 2022. For now, industrial contaminants are not a problem in Lake Quinsigamond. In 2019, the Lakes and Ponds program joined forces with the local watershed associations to create an angler survey to get an idea of, amongst other things, what people were catching in our waterways. Unsurprisingly, Lake Quinsigamond supports some great fishing. Respondents reported catching at least 21 species of warm and cold water fish, including brown trout, rainbow smelt, and largemouth bass, in addition to rainbow trout, with which it is stocked twice annually in the spring and fall. So if you like fishing and you haven't already, you should definitely check out Lake Quinsigamond. This all brings us to the state of the lake. We base this assessment on an average ranking of different parameters using a scale of poor to excellent, with poor meaning that ecology and recreation are severely reduced and new management is necessary, and excellent meaning that there is no perceived threat to ecology or recreational value. In 2020, Lake Quinsigamond had some challenges with fecal bacteria causing beach closures, especially at Regatta Point, though the open water seems unaffected. While beach closures are affecting recreation, we give it a fair, because with more frequent monitoring, we can reduce the time the beaches are closed. We are looking to better understand chronic bacteria with a new interagency bacteria monitoring program. For cyanobacteria, clarity, and nutrient issues, we found that during the summer months, things are excellent and more than safe for recreation, especially in the open water. However, the lake received a fair because in 2020 we experienced blooms in the winter months, which we will need to study more to better understand the cause of. The invasive plant management plan has worked effectively up to this point, and so the lake gets a good. We continue to support the Lake Quinsigamond Commission in implementing the management plan. We know that there is an invasive mollusk in the lake, but we don't yet understand the extent to which it is affecting the ecosystem. This will be studied more in 2021. There are no traces of contaminants in levels that would be harmful to humans or the environment, and so the lake receives a grade of excellent for industrial contaminants. We will retest in 2022 to make sure this remains the case. Finally, litter at Lake Quinsigamond came to a head in 2020, and it was seen around the perimeter. However, we currently do not have a means to quantify it. We are working with a team of student researchers at WPI to create a methodology to do this in the future. After this all shakes out, we gave Lake Quinsigamond a rating of good in 2020 and hope to continue to monitor some of the ongoing open questions that we have. Thank you so much for joining us for this summary of water quality in Lake Quinsigamond in 2020. More detailed information can be found in the water quality reports. Also, be sure to check out the other videos in the 2020 State of the Lake series to learn about what the city and the community are doing together to help keep our blue spaces beautiful.